mechanism. Amongst the local cardiovascular regulatory mechanisms, as we'll be doing and talking in two lectures, one after the another, the first one is discussion about the local cardiovascular regulatory mechanism. That is what they want you to know. That is a competency here. So describe and discuss the local CVS regulatory mechanisms. Describe and discuss systemic cardiovascular regulatory mechanisms. Identify the paracrine factors and hormones that regulate vascular tone, their sources and mechanism of action. So we'll be studying about nitric oxide, endothelins, kinins, which are bradykinin, histamine, and a little bit about the peptides which are released from the heart and the brain, atrial natriuretic peptide and the other peptides, right? So this all we will have to do in the first hour of the lecture, and then we will be proceeding towards blood pressure and its regulation. So today your earlier class got over at around 10:30 only, so you have had a good break, right? So I will like you to now concentrate so that we can move ahead. So, and finally, we'll also be discussing in the beginning that what is the concept of autoregulation and what do I mean by the various theories of autoregulation, which is certainly a short note asked in the exam. So let's quickly go through some important slides. What are the main functions of cardiovascular regulatory mechanisms? They increase the blood supply to active tissues, as we say. They can increase or decrease the heat loss from the body, right, by redistributing the blood. This, I think, I've already told you about that. Suppose we are in hot weather, then we will like to do vasodilation so that more blood is diverted towards the skin surface and I lose heat and my body temperature comes down. If I am in cold weather, then I will do vasoconstriction, right? That is the meaning of the second line. Third, we'll be discussing in detail in shock. So whenever you have hemorrhage, you are losing blood, then you will definitely like to maintain blood flow to the various organs, right? Which are the key organs here, which will show the autoregulation. Remember, autoregulation is very strong in heart, brain, and kidney. These three organs show me very good autoregulation. Today, you have had a lecture of coronary and cerebral circulation. Right, so the concerned resident must have told you about that these three organs, especially these two, show a very good autoregulation in the range of when the mean arterial pressure is in the range of 60 to 200 millimeter mercury for the heart, 65 to 140 millimeter for the brain, and 70 to 170 for the kidney, right? Kidney will be teaching you separately. So probably you can relate things here. So the cardiovascular system and the brain, the cerebral circulation shows me a very good autoregulation. What do I mean by autoregulation, right? And various theories of autoregulation. So let us discuss the next point here. So remember, autoregulation is very strong in these organs, which I have written, very strong in heart, brain, and kidney. What do I mean by autoregulation? The autoregulation simply means, the capacity of the tissues, to maintain a constant blood flow despite changes, in the mean arterial pressure, or some books only write blood pressure. Today we'll be discussing everything in the next part of the lecture within a certain range. So again, I will repeat, what is the meaning of autoregulation? The capacity or the ability of the tissues to maintain a constant blood flow despite changes in the mean arterial pressure or blood pressure within a certain range. If I plot a very simple graph of this thing, I can say like this, that let us say this is the mean arterial pressure, in, of course, millimeter mercury, and this is the blood flow. So what I can say is that within this certain range, which will vary for each organ, this line is straight. That means although the mean arterial pressure is going to rise, if suppose this is CVS system or the heart, from 60 to 200, the blood flow is not changing. If it is brain, then this will become 65 to 140. If it is kidney, it will become 70 to 170. This simple thing is known as autoregulation of the blood flow. What's the reason behind the autoregulation? Must to know what is the reason behind autoregulation, right? So there are actually two main theories of autoregulation which you need to remember. Two main theories of the autoregulation. The first theory is theories of autoregulation is what I'm discussing next. Theories of autoregulation. So the first theory is known by the name myogenic theory. This is something which is related to your smooth muscle. Myogenic theory. What exactly do I mean by myogenic theory? The myogenic theory simply states, the myogenic theory simply tells me ability of the smooth muscle to constrict in response to an increased blood pressure. Let us draw a flowchart to understand this. So let me say that the mean arterial pressure is increasing. If the mean arterial pressure is increasing, then this should lead to increase in blood flow. But as soon as the mean arterial pressure will increase, it will also cause, it will now cause something else as well. So let's see what. So increase in, and this you have studied in smooth muscle, I will be telling you about the theory which actually you should be able to recall now if you have been reading thoroughly, right? So increased mean arterial pressure should lead to this. But what happens now? I want that the blood flow should remain same. How will that happen? So as soon as there is an increase in mean arterial pressure, there occurs increased stretching of the smooth muscle of the blood vessel. Which blood vessel? Definitely, which are my main resistance vessels? We have studied in hemodynamics, arterioles. So again, I'm repeating, increase in mean arterial pressure leads to increased stretching of the smooth muscle of the blood vessel, increased smooth muscle stretching of the smooth muscle of the blood vessel, which will cause opening of stretch sensitive calcium channels. Remember, you have studied till now a lot of channels. You have been taught voltage gated, mechanically gated. Mechanically gated is another name for the channels which open due to stretch. So as soon as there is opening of stretch sensitive calcium channels, now the things will become easy. There is increased calcium influx. Increased calcium influx will cause increased contraction of the smooth muscle of the blood vessel or the arteriole. Increased contraction of the smooth muscle of the blood vessel or the arteriole means if the arteriole constricts, you know, the radius will reduce. That means this will cause increase in total peripheral resistance or increase in vascular resistance. And as soon as the vascular resistance increases, we are done here, that this will lead to autoregulation of the blood flow, right? So if you draw this flow chart for me in the exam, it's wonderful. If you can't draw a flow chart, although flow charts are much, much easier to draw, they relate things logically. and we are able to memorize things for a longer time. Instead of maybe you start writing in paragraphs, all these important things, maybe you are writing correct, but a person who is drawing a flow chart or a diagram in the exam definitely edges out a person like you who maybe might be drawing only a paragraph or writing just some lines, right? Because this gives a nicer picture. It makes the examiner understand that you that you are totally through with the subject, and definitely it will give you an extra mark, right? So this is all about the myogenic theory. So again, let's quickly revise in 1 minute. So whenever there is increasing mean arterial pressure, there would be increasing blood flow, which should happen, but it will cause increase in stretching of smooth muscle, opening of stress sensitive calcium channels, which is this theory, if I ask you, related to the smooth muscle. Remember, in the excitation contraction coupling in the smooth muscle can occur via various mechanisms. The excitation contraction coupling in the smooth muscle can act via various mechanisms. It could be, we say, electromechanical coupling, electrochemical coupling, and something like this one, which is occurring, an example of stress sensitive or mechanically gated channels opening, right? So myogenic theory, that is the first theory for autoregulation. Let's look at the second theory now. The second theory is, in fact, the much easier one. The second theory is the metabolic theory. So the second theory is metabolic theory. And once we have understood this very quickly, we'll see the figures of the same from various books. So metabolic theory simply tells me there are two ways to understand. Whenever there is decreased blood flow to an organ or tissue. So whenever there is decreased blood flow to an organ or the tissue, it will lead to increased accumulation of the vasodilator metabolites. Remember, if I am having less blood flow, you can ask me, why are you having less blood flow? Then definitely I will say, because my mean arterial pressure is less, right? Or that if my BP is less, my organ will receive less blood flow. Or maybe when the blood flow is less, then I am going to accumulate the metabolites, which are the waste metabolites, the most commonly ones, which all do vasodilation. If I have to quickly write down a list, then I'll say decrease in PO2, increase in PCO2, increase in hydrogen ion, decrease in pH, increase in lactate. And today you have studied one which you should be now able to relate if you just listen to her, whatever she was telling you. Adenosine. Adenosine is a very important vasodilator, especially in the coronary circulation, very important role in myocardial ischemia, increase in osmolality. Increase in osmolality, increase in adenosine, right? Increase in potassium. So two here are very important to relate from earlier class from today. Whenever there is increase in partial pressure of carbon dioxide, the CO2 has the most pronounced vasodilator effect on the cerebral circulation. And adenosine has been implicated to increase the blood flow in the coronary circulation. So whenever there is decreased blood flow to an organ, whenever there is decreased blood flow to an organ, there would be increased accumulation of the vasodilator metabolites. Increased accumulation of the vasodilator metabolites, as it is written over here, will lead to vasodilation. We all understand, decrease in total peripheral resistance. Decreased total peripheral resistance means I will have decrease. The decrease in total peripheral resistance means I will have a very quick increase in blood flow. That means this problem has been taken care of. What could be the another way the metabolic theory can work for us? The metabolic theory can work in the another way. If I have increase in the tissue metabolism, I'm having more metabolism in the tissues, increased tissue metabolism will lead to decreased oxygen delivery to the tissues, or again decrease in PO2 and increase in PCO2, hydrogen ion, and same thing, this all will lead to decrease in total peripheral resistance, leading to increased blood flow, right? So very simple two theories, metabolic and myogenic. Myogenic, remember, myo means muscle, smooth muscle, genic related to smooth muscle, right? So once we know about these two theories, let's look at some figures from Guyton and let's move ahead. So regulatory mechanisms are mainly divided into two regulatory mechanisms, systemic and local autoregulatory mechanisms. Systemic we'll be discussing later on. They are chemical and neural, neural related to the nerves and the innervation, chemical related to some factors which are being released. Local autoregulatory mechanisms, already I've talked about it. They operate to maintain blood flow through an organ at a constant level despite changes in mean arterial pressure. This is a figure which is showing me a figure from Guyton. The only thing to understand is, in exam you can draw the figure which I had drawn for you, because if you draw this one, you need to be absolutely clear what is this acute versus long term. So what they are trying to tell me is that acutely, whenever there is increase in mean arterial pressure, the constancy of the line is for a very short period, but when we have a long term autoregulation, the line is straight. That means acute is occurring over a period of few hours or minutes. Long term autoregulation would be much better because it is occurring after a period of continuous increase in mean arterial pressure, maybe for some hours. So what is the role for, how is the long term autoregulation different from acute? For acute, already I've told you two theories, myogenic and metabolic. For chronic generally, or for long term, they say the main reason is something known by the term angiogenesis. Angio means blood vessel, genesis means synthesis. So angiogenesis is nothing but increased synthesis and production of blood vessels, or growth of new blood vessels. Increased formation of new blood vessels, right? That is angiogenesis. Angiogenesis can occur in response to ischemia to the tissue, decreased blood flow. It can happen in a rapidly growing tissue, because if a tissue is growing, I will definitely need to grow its blood supply as well. So ischemia, rapidly growing tissue, and definitely tissues with high metabolic rates, because if you have high metabolic rates, I need to provide you more blood flow, so I will need to synthesize new blood vessels. So angiogenesis is nothing but formation of new blood vessels. It can happen due to these factors. In response to these factors, various angiogenic factors are released, which are known by the name, let me write down few for you, which is VEGF, vascular endothelial growth factor, PEGF, platelet derived endothelial growth factor. So VEGF, vascular endothelial growth factor, platelet endothelial growth factor, fibroblast growth factor, FGF. So again, I'll repeat, vascular endothelial, platelet derived, and EGF will remain same for each one. Endothelial growth factor, V is vascular endothelial growth factor, then platelet derived endothelial growth factor, and in the last one, fibroblast growth factor, right? So these are the factors which will be released whenever there is ischemia or increased metabolism of the tissues, or tissues are rapidly growing, and the long-term autoregulation, which is due to angiogenesis, is going to be much better than the acute and will be sustained for a longer term, because now I have synthesized new blood vessels. But we all understand this is going to take time. It will not be an overnight process. It will take much more amount of time. On the contrary, the acute theory, which is immediate, I want that the blood flow should not increase to a tissue when the mean arterial pressure is increasing. For that, I will have my myogenic and metabolic theories, right? So long-term regulation definitely is more effective, as we have understood by now, because it is causing synthesis of new blood vessels. So it is more effective. And also, to say the least, we can say that it is basically causing increase in size and number of blood vessels, right? So this is the autoregulation of blood vessels. So then this is the figure which I've already drawn for you, so no need to repeat. And this is a Laplace law which you have studied earlier. Let's look at the myogenic mechanism application of the Laplace law. Remember, the T was equal to P into R, or I can say P was equal to P upon R. What they are trying to tell us is that if the pressure is increasing, then the tension in the wall of viscous will increase, right? So the only way to decrease the pressure, the only way, let's see this one. So T is equal to P into R. It's the same thing, but I'm just telling you in the above one. So T is equal to P into R. So what happens and divided by 2W, here I am not discussing the width. So let's only look at T, P, and R. So they are telling us that if the P is increasing, then naturally tension will increase. How can I take care of this? By only one way, by decreasing the radius, right? On the contrary, if P is decreasing, then the tension will decrease. Now, the only way I can maintain a constant tension is by increasing the radius. That means in response to increase in mean arterial pressure, you will do vasodilation. In response to decrease in mean arterial pressure, you will like to do vasoconstriction. That's it, right? This is just the same thing. Metabolic theory already we have talked about. So which are some locally acting vasodilators? Already I've given you the list: hypoxia, hypercapnia, increased blood osmolality, increased body temperature, potassium, lactic acid, adenosine, decreased blood pH, or increase in hydrogen ion, right? These are some locally acting vasodilators. Whenever they accumulate, they will increase the blood flow. Right? So locally acting vasodilators. This is the metabolic theory, again, picture taken from Guyton. Nothing but they are just showing us as the rate of metabolism is increasing and becoming many times normal, the blood flow is also continuously increasing. So increase in tissue metabolism leads to increase in blood flow. You already know the reason. Increased tissue metabolism will cause decrease in PO2, increase in PCO2, and accumulation of other vasodilator metabolites. Then again, the same theory, increased tissue metabolism leads to increased release of vasodilators, decrease in arterial resistance, increase in blood flow, right? So I'll just skip on to this. Already we have talked about. This is the same figure which I had drawn for you, mean arterial pressure, showing me the tissue organ blood flow. As the mean arterial pressure is increasing, almost within this range, the blood flow remains constant, right? This is an acute, had it been chronic, it would be much, much straighter, right? Because of the angiogenesis. Okay, let's see now the role of endothelial cells and some factors which are produced by the endothelial cells. So endothelial cells, endothelium of the blood vessels secrete a variety of the substances in response to stretch, increase in blood flow, and inflammatory mediators. So various substances are being released, which are known as vasoactive substances. We'll be discussing in short about them. So prostaglandins, thromboxane, nitric oxide, endothelin. So let's start with these factors which are released from the endothelium of the blood vessel in response to variety of inflammation mediators or stretch of the blood vessel. So prostacyclin versus thromboxane A2, right? So just have to remember two things here, that both the prostacyclin and the thromboxane A2 are synthesized from a common precursor at a pathway known as cyclooxygenase pathway, and the substrate is arachidonic acid. This we will do in detail in biochem. So let's understand what we need to talk about from the physiological aspect. Thromboxane A2 is produced by the platelets. It basically has action opposite to prostacyclin. Thromboxane A2 is produced by the platelets It causes platelet aggregation and vasoconstriction. Prostacyclin is produced by the endothelial cells. It promotes vasodilation and inhibits platelet aggregation. So this much we all can make out that their actions are opposite, right? So this just one thing I will like you to tell you here, which can be asked in viva, and you can relate this to the arachidonic acid from the biochemistry pathway. So we'll just save on some time and understand what happens if we give low dose aspirin to a patient, right? So just understand, we are giving a low dose aspirin to a patient. So generally, it has been seen that if I put a patient on a low dose aspirin, which is a very common drug, mind you, it is very useful in preventing the myocardial infarction, unstable angina. You must have been taught today in coronary circulation. Angina means chest pain. It could be of two types, stable and unstable, right? So stable can occur when you are basically at rest, also unstable when you exercise or do physical activity. Transient ischemic attacks means ischemia means decreased blood flow to the brain. Transient means it occurs only for short duration. Stroke, decreased blood flow to the brain, or hemorrhage, ischemic stroke, or ischemic stroke, right? So aspirin is a wonder drug which has been given a role that if I put a patient on a chronic low dose aspirin, it is very useful in preventing the myocardial infarctions, unstable angina, and other these diseases. Why? What is the reason behind this? Let's quickly look at this pathway, which you will be taught in more detail in biochem, but I'll tell you what I need you to know here. So when I give aspirin, the aspirin is N-acetyl salicylic acid, and there is an enzyme known as cyclooxygenase 1. Just focus on this one. So what the aspirin does is, aspirin produces irreversible inhibition of it produces irreversible inhibition of cyclooxygenase 1 enzyme. It produces irreversible inhibition of cyclooxygenase 1 enzyme by doing the acetylation of the COX enzyme at the amino acid serine site. Again, I will repeat, the aspirin, when you give, it causes irreversible inhibition of the COX-1 enzyme by doing acetylation of the serine residue in its active site. So basically, acetylates, which is being shown here, this is acetylic acid, is the acetylation of the serine. As soon as I do acetylation of the serine, the enzyme becomes inactivated. What will happen when the enzyme will become inactivated? Just focus on the above thing. When the enzyme becomes inactivated, this will lead to decrease in synthesis of thromboxane A2, and it will also decrease the synthesis of prostacyclin. But what is going to happen is, thromboxane A2 is produced by platelets, and prostacyclin is produced by endothelial cells. Mind you, you have decreased the production of both, but endothelial cells are able to produce new prostacyclin within a matter of few hours. They produce new prostacyclin within few hours. Why? Because endothelial cells are quick to synthesize new prostacyclin. But the platelets on the other hand cannot manufacture or synthesize the thromboxane A2 quickly. It cannot synthesize because platelets have a half-life of 4 days. So platelets need time to synthesize new thromboxane A2. So platelets The platelets cannot manufacture the enzyme and cannot synthesize the thromboxane A2 because of increased half-life of the platelets, which is around 4 days. Sorry, this is, should be 4 days. So which is around 4 days. So let me again quickly recap. So when we give aspirin, there is the cyclooxygen enzyme, which is inactivated by a cytylation at the serine site. This should lead to decrease both thromboxane A2 and prostacycline. Prostacycline I am able to synthesize in a few hours by endothelial cells, but platelets are not able to synthesize thromboxane A2 because they have a prolonged half-life of 4 days. They will need more time. Now, what is going to happen if you keep on giving aspirin low dose to the patient continuously, he's taking every day, then what is going to happen? This pathway, thromboxane A2 synthesis will be decreased and the prostacycline synthesis will be restored. That means I will favor on giving continuous low dose aspirin to the patient. We are going to shift the pathway towards the favorable prostacycline increase. And once the prostacycline increases there, you know, prostacycline causes vasodilation and inhibits platelet aggregation. So there are less chances of clots in the circulation, whether it is heart, whether it is brain, whether it is anywhere else, right? So this is the significance. The more detail you will be taught in pharmacology when you go next year. So don't worry as of now. This was the only question which they generally don't ask in physiology. They will only ask if you are telling all the other things correctly, right? So maybe this is something like a 75 plus question or a distinction question, right? So let's move on to now the very important next one, which is the nitric oxide in the list. So let's understand the second one, which is nitric oxide. Nitric oxide is a very important question for the exam. That not only from the theory viewpoint, but also can be asked in viva voice, right? Very, very important, nitric oxide. So let's see what we need to know about the NO. You must have heard about it, soluble gas, nitric oxide, endothelial derived relaxation factor, another name for the same, EDRF, as we like to call it in short, right? So NO or EDRF is same. Let's look at some historical aspects of the nitric oxide, which they will like you to know. Nitric oxide is a free radical, highly reactive in nature. It was discovered by Furchtgott and Zawazaki. It was discovered by Furchtgott and Zawazaki in the year 1980. So not even just a 40-year-old molecule. And it is an endogenous activator of soluble gonyl cyclase. You have studied in biochem. You must be knowing this. Let's look at the nitric oxide synthesis pathway. And then we will talk about what is its role. Very, very important figure taken directly from Genome. Just to save some time, I'm not writing all this, but I'll tell you some key important features to remember the difficult things here, right? So let's see the pathway. Nitric oxide is synthesized from the substrate known as arginine. So L-arginine plus oxygen plus NADPH are the substrates, especially the arginine. And I will synthesize citrulline plus nitric oxide, NO. This reaction above one is occurring in endothelial cells. It requires various cofactors also, such as thiol, tetrahydrobiopterin, flavin-adenine dinucleotide, and flavine mononucleotide, right? So this you all know from the biochem. And let's move to the main important understandable thing here. Acetylcholine, bradykinin, and shear stress. What is shear stress? Whenever the blood flows, the fluid layers or the blood flow layers move past each other, they create a shearing or a stressful force on the endothelium. So these three things, the acetylcholine, bradykinin, and the shear stress will cause increase in calcium or activate calcium, which will stimulate Nitric oxide synthase. NOS is the enzyme useful in the synthesis of nitric oxide. It is known by the term NOS, NOS, nitric oxide synthase. So once the nitric oxide synthase or the nitric oxide has been synthesized, it will now move to, these are my smooth muscle cells. Please understand this very, very carefully. This is very important. Don't worry, I'll tell you some easy mnemonics to remember things in a while. So nitric oxide is synthesized from arginine, and then I produce citrulline with nitric oxide, which is produced in the endothelial cells. The nitric oxide will diffuse to the smooth muscle cells and will activate the enzyme known as Gonyl cyclase will convert GTP to cyclic GMP. What is GTP? Guanine triphosphate. What is GMP? Guanine monophosphate. The gonyl cyclase converts GTP to GMP, and GMP is the important one which is going to produce smooth muscle relaxation. GMP causes smooth muscle relaxation. Please see carefully what I am writing now. The cyclic GMP is converted to, or is metabolized to 5-GMP. Must have been taught in biochemistry, right? Otherwise, we will teach you a little bit in endocrinology. So cyclic GMP is converted to 5-GMP by the enzyme phosphodiesterases. Why are we learning this? This one is the favorite of all the examiners, right? So cyclic GMP is converted to the 5-GMP or is degraded into 5-GMP by the enzyme phosphodiesterases. Let us say scientists have produced some drugs which inhibit this. Some drugs which inhibit phosphodiesterases. If I inhibit phosphodiesterases, then the cyclic GMP levels are going to remain high for a longer time. Yes or no? Of course, yes. Why? Because it won't be degraded. And this is a very, very important clinical viva question and application for you, that if I gave the phosphodiesterase inhibitor drugs such as the drug known as tadalafil, vardenafil. What are these drugs? Sildenafil, vardenafil, tadalafil. These are nothing but, as you know by the name, Viagra, given for the treatment of erectile dysfunction in the males, right? So given for the treatment of erectile dysfunction in males. So you must have heard about it. You must have been knowing about this, have been made quite popular by a lot of jokes, right, in the movies. So, but as of coming to the scientific literature part, you need to be aware. As a first year student, I can ask you in Viva, when we go to take Viva in other universities, other colleges, this is one of the favorite questions of the examiners. So the drugs like Viagra, they will inhibit the phosphodiesterase enzyme, prolong the cyclic GMP, which will increase the smooth muscle relaxation, especially in your penile muscles, which are corpora cavernosa, and they will increase the blood flow to the penile tissue, leading to sustained and prolonged erection. So a very important drug given to the, or prescribed to the patients for erectile dysfunction, right? So one of the important roles of NO. Now let's go back to nitric oxide. How will I remember this? I'll tell you the other roles of nitric oxide in a while. So before I tell you the other things, let's quickly understand the other roles of nitric oxide. So one of the roles is nitric oxide. Nitric oxide is causing relaxation of the smooth muscle. Nitric oxide is causing relaxation of the smooth muscle. So it's a very important vasodilator. Because remember, if I'm relaxing the smooth muscle, I can decrease your total peripheral resistance. It is a very important vasodilator. Nitric oxide synthetic preparations are available in the market by the name nitroglycerin. Right? Nitroglycerin, one of the important preparations available in the market. Nitroglycerin, nitroprusside. They are commonly given as they will do vasodilation. As they will do vasodilation, they will generally or they reduce preload to the heart. So important drugs given to the patients of heart failure where there is excessive venous return and I want that the preload should reduce. Also given to the patients in treatment of angina if somebody is having chest pain and I do vasodilation, right? So I can reduce the preload to the heart so that heart can contract and beat with a good force. So treatment of angina, heart failure. We'll be talking about heart failure in a separate class. Just focus on important vasodilator as of now. The another important thing is its role in penile erection. As I've already told you, it causes vasodilation of the corpora cavernosa. Vasodilation of the corpora cavernosa in the penile tissue. Nitric oxide has been also described as neurotransmitter in the brain. Nitric oxide role has been also prescribed in the treatment of hypertension, as hypertension is due to sustained increase in blood pressure. When I will do vasodilation, the blood pressure will decrease, right? Also, nitric oxide role is there in the cytotoxicity. Its role is there in the cytotoxicity. When I say cytotoxicity, that means the nitric oxide has an antimicrobial role or action. Antimicrobial role means it has a cytotoxic action against the pathogens. Against the pathogens. Now, how will you remember this all? Let's go back to arginine and this figure. So, the very easy way to remember this is just remember arginine, nitric oxide, and citrulline. Rest probably you never forget, but don't tell me reverse that the nitric oxide is synthesized from citrulline. No, it is synthesized from arginine. And the way to remember this is just pick up the first letters A N C. A N C. When you start going to the gynecology and obstetrics wards, this is a very common thing which each female pregnant patient is subjected to, and she should be having this in pregnancy. It is known as antenatal checkup. That means pregnancy checkup, checkup in the pregnant stage, antenatal checkup. So ANC, arginine, nitric oxide, citrulline, right? So remember the first thing. Another problem in this figure is, although it has been taken from Genome, that some people will tell you that there are various isoforms of nitric oxide synthase. NOS has various types. Yes, do I need to know this? Yes, in very brief, and just what I'll tell you that you should remember. NOS1, NOS2, NOS3, nitric oxide 1, nitric oxide 2, nitric oxide 3, right? Where are they located? So the nitric oxide synthase is a family of enzymes which are collectively called the NOS. They are of various types. The nitric oxide synthase 1 and 3, they are both कॉन्स्टिट्यूटिव, कॉन्स्टिट्यूटिव का मीनिंग होता है ऑलवेज प्रेजेंट, ऑलवेज प्रेजेंट, दे आर कॉन्स्टिट्यूटिव, दिस इज मेनली प्रेजेंट इन सेंट्रल नर्वस सिस्टम, सीएनएस, ब्रेन ऑल्सो यू कैन से, एक ही बात है. द नाइट्रिक ऑक्साइड 3 इज मेनली प्रेजेंट इन एंडोथीलियल सेल्स. And the nitric oxide 2 is not constitutive. Please remember, it is inducible. It will be only produced in response to a pathology. So, when I say it will be only to produce in response to a pathological situation, commonly I mean to say that these are seen in macrophages. What are the other types of macrophages in various tissues? You know them by the various names, which is the neutrophils. So they can be present in neutrophils, they can be present in Kupffer cells, right? So they are produced in response to a pathology or a pathological stimuli. How will I remember nitric oxide 1, 2, 3? And which nitric oxide, if I go back and ask you, should be this one? This NOS should be 1, 2, or 3. Now you immediately look that, sir, this is endothelial cell, so this should be NOS3. That is why if I write NOS3 here, this becomes a better figure. And this is what is the change which happened in Genome. In the older edition, they were only writing NOS. In the new edition, now they are writing NOS3, right? And how will I remember the various isoforms location of NOS? Again, one more mnemonic for you people to remember. Remember, we as a doctors have a continued medical education in our careers. We continued and you continue to attend conferences. As you are attending my lecture, maybe I will also go to some conference to update my knowledge and will try to understand the further important the molecular level thing. And as a student, you will keep on also attending various conferences, lectures during your course of 5 years. So what happens is, of 4.5 years, so they just pick up the first letters here. And we have a very easy mnemonic, 1, 2, 3, nitric oxide, 1, 2, 3. And the mnemonic is CME. CME is something which now you are hearing for the first time, maybe today, but this you will keep on learning for your entire life as doctors. And CME stands for continued medical education. Continued medical education, right? So CNS, macrophage, endothelial, that's it. Continued medical education. So we are done with nitric oxide. Let's see some figures of the nitric oxide, and then I will move on to, the endothelins and the last two which are left in this class, right? So let's start with quickly see. I'll show you some figures, the important ones. Yes, this is a figure which is giving me a physiological role of nitric oxide. Remember, E means the constitutive one. E nitric oxide means the constitutive one, which is always present. So it can be produced in response to endothelial stimulation. But please understand here, this is macrophage. So this is INOS. I means inducible, NOS2. So whenever we have the nitric oxide synthesis, it can produce by reacting with oxygen of free radicals such as hydroxyl, and they have a very good cytotoxic power. They can kill the microbes. Right. Also, they will reduce the platelet adhesion. The nitric oxide reduces the platelet adhesion. It's a vasodilator because it decreases the platelet adhesion. Definitely, it will reduce the occurrence of the various thrombogenic events in the circulation or clot formation. So, decrease platelet adhesion. Other things I've already talked about, so we'll just leave it here. One interesting thing before I tell you about the endothelin, since the COVID is going on since last 1.5, 2 years almost, some people are trying to give this inhaled nitric oxide nasal sprays. And they are Right now, trying it out. When I give nitric oxide nasal spray directly into your nostrils, then it is supposed to decrease the COVID cases or the occurrence by almost 70 to 90%, right? But this is still under trial, so they have not yet finalized or passed this, right? Endothelins. So endothelins are one of the most potent vasoconstrictor substances. They are a family of 321 amino acid polypeptides. Endothelins are a family of 321 amino acid polypeptides known by the name endothelin 1, endothelin 2, endothelin 3. If you forget everything else about the endothelin, you just have to remember that they are very, very potent vasoconstrictors. They are mainly produced in endothelium and they have a key role in vascular homeostasis. They are most potent or one of the most potent vasoconstrictor agents. There are three isoforms, endothelin 1, endothelin 2, endothelin 3. So there is not much for me to describe here. That is why I'm showing you these slides. We'll just go through them quickly so that we can start with the blood pressure and its regulation, which is the topic for the next hour. So endothelin 1 is commonly present in the brains and in the brain, kidneys, and endothelial cells. 2 is in kidneys and intestine, and 3 is present in brain, blood, kidneys, and GIT, and where not. That means you only need to remember that which is not in brain. So ET2 is not present in brain. That can be the only MCQ which can be framed here or the question, right? So they are one of the most potent vasoconstrictor agents. As they are vasoconstrictors, what are their actions going to be on various tissues? I'll just tell you in a while. So endothelins have two types of receptors. The two key receptors, this all information is in Guyton and Ganong, and all the Indian authors book also give it properly. So there are two key receptors, endothelin A and B. Just remember, E receptor is specific for endothelin 1. And ETB is responding to all the three. That means it's non-specific. This is coupled by a G protein to phospholipase 2C. That means it's a group 2C pathway. Group 2C is the one which is coupled to phospholipase C. And this is found in many tissues. It mainly mediates vasoconstriction. On the other hand, this is coupled to GI. It mediates vasodilation. ETB receptor is a much, much lesser in occurrence in comparison to ETA because the main action, remember, is vasoconstriction. The functions of the endothelin, it's a very important role of paracrine regulator of vascular tone. Remember, you have studied this, might have studied before coming here, otherwise we will teach you in endocrinology. There are endocrine substances which are released into the bloodstream. They can act on distant organs. There are paracrine which just acts on neighboring tissues. Para, neighboring. Nazdeek, as I say in Hindi, right? Nazdeek or neighboring tissues. So paracrine, endocrine, ek hota hai autocrine. Autocrine means on its own, right? So three things are there. Endocrine acts on distant organs through blood. Paracrine only on neighboring tissues. Autocrine apne aap pe acts on its own, autocrine, right? So this will be teaching you in kidney that endothelin receptors are present on mesangial cells, which participates in tubuloglomerular feedback. Don't worry, just read this line as of now. We'll be teaching you in detail in kidney, right? They play a role in closing ductus arteriosus at birth. This we also will be telling you in fetal circulation, right? So regulation of secretion, the only point I will write you to remember here is that endothelin 1 is not stored in secretory granules. Kahin pe granules mein stored nahi hota hai. It is always the regulatory factors either increase or decrease its synthesis through the transcription and translation which you have studied in the normal genetic makeup, right? So whenever I want to increase its synthesis, there are substances known as stimulators which will increase the transcription of the gene. Increase gene transcription, and when I want to decrease, I will decrease the genetic transcription. Nitric oxide, ANP, atrial natriuretic peptide, prostaglandin E2, prostacycline, they all inhibit. That means they will inhibit the vasoconstrictor effects of endothelin, because they are decreasing endothelin. Stimulators are angiotensin 2, catecholamine, growth factors, hypoxia, insulin, oxidized LDL. When the LDL is low density lipoprotein, high density lipoprotein, shear stress, thrombin. Right? So again, this table has been taken from Ganong. It is given clearly in the Ganong. Let's quickly write down about some actions of the endothelins and what important ones at least I will like you to remember. Actions of endothelins. So endothelins, remember, hemodynamically we say they are vasoconstrictors. They constrict the smooth muscle. But remember, we generally say now, as the research tells us, veins are more sensitive than arteries. That means they will do a much better venoconstriction than arteriolar constriction, although they will do both. And you know, venoconstriction will increase the venous return and will increase the blood volume. That is the first thing to remember. So they are very good vasoconstrictors. What are the effects on cardiac tissue? On cardiac tissue, they generally increase heart rate, they increase stroke volume, they cause increased cardiac output, because you know heart rate into stroke volume is nothing but cardiac output. What is the third tissue we need to remember? So they have a neuroendocrine role. Neuroendocrine means they can act as synaptic transmitters. They increase the synaptic transmission in the central nervous system. That is a neuroendocrine action. They also increase the plasma levels of atrial natriuretic peptide, aldosterone, renin. What are the effects on the kidney? In kidney, because they will do vasoconstriction, they decrease the glomerular filtration rate, they decrease the renal blood flow. This we'll be teaching you in kidney, don't worry. The important last one on the lungs. This question was asked in one of the exams 2-3 years back. In lungs, as they will do constriction. If you remember that mainly endothelins are constrictors, you will never go wrong. So they will do bronchoconstriction, right? That was the question. What is their action on the lungs? Pulmonary effects. And in GIT, last one, in GIT, they increase gluconeogenesis, right? And regulate the gastrointestinal blood flow and regulates the GIT blood flow. So this is all about endothelins, which I will like you to remember. Just remember, the key point here is they are one of the very good vasoconstrictors. Let's do the last two, which are bradykinin and the atrial natriuretic peptide. So we have humoral regulation of the blood flow. Humoral means the factors which are released into the blood. Now they could be vasoconstrictors such as norepinephrine and epinephrine, angiotensin 2 and vasopressin. Vasopressin, as you know, another name is antidiuretic hormone. Angiotensin 2 we'll be discussing in detail in the blood pressure regulation along with renin, angiotensin, aldosterone system. Vasodilator agents which are humoral released into bloodstream are bradykinin, VIP, which stands for vasoactive intestinal peptide, and natriuretic hormones. So let's quickly go through the vasodilator ones. Angiotensin 2, I am leaving for now. We'll be discussing in detail once I do RAS or renin angiotensin aldosterone system. Kinins. Just see the key points here, which I've already highlighted for you. There are two related vasodilator peptides called kinins, which are found in body. One is bradykinin, which is a nonapeptide. Nonapeptide means having 9 amino acids. And lysyl bradykinin or kallidin, which is having a 10 amino acid decapeptide. Mainly, they are found primarily in tissue hormones, but they are also found in circulating blood. What are their main actions? They cause contraction of visceral smooth muscle, but more important is they relax the vascular smooth muscle via increasing the synthesis of nitric oxide, so they will lower the BP. So they cause vasodilation by increasing the nitric oxide synthesis. So they will cause decrease in blood pressure. They also increase capillary permeability. They also increase leukocyte adhesion or attract leukocyte, and they produce pain on getting injected in the skin, right? So under skin, when I inject them, I produce pain. Let's look at the figure of Ganong, where how are they synthesized is given. So let's quickly look at these two pictures from Ganong, which generally students find difficult to understand. Let's look at one by one. The above one is showing me that this is a bradykinin. This is a lysyl bradykinin or kallidin. This is lysyl bradykinin or kallidin. There are two types of receptors, bradykinin type 1 receptors and bradykinin type 2 receptors. Through the action of the enzyme kinase 1, I can remove these two arginine amino acids, and thus are produced desarginine kallidin or desarginine bradykinin. Des means without the this arginine. Remember, doesn't have any R. So without the arginine, they are known as desarginine kallidin or desarginine bradykinin. They act on receptors B1R or bradykinin type 1 receptors, and these are the receptors which have been ascribed the role in pain. That is what I will like you to remember here. Very important and difficult MCQ. B1R are the receptors which are involved in pain production by bradykinins. B2R or bradykinin 2 receptors have no role in pain. That means nowadays the pharmacological companies are trying to manufacture drugs which inhibit the action of the kinins on the B1R receptor, thereby reducing the pain, right? So how are bradykinins synthesized? This is the picture from Ganong again. Let's quickly look at this one more picture, and then I move to the next topic. So we have the plasma prekallikrein from which the plasma kallikrein is synthesized, and the plasma kallikrein produces bradykinin from high molecular weight kininogen. So what is the substrate for bradykinin? High molecular weight kininogen, HMW, high molecular weight kininogen. How do I produce from high molecular weight kininogen bradykinin? Through the action of plasma kallikrein. But they are present in inactive forms or the precursor forms, which are produced from the plasma prekallikrein to plasma kallikrein via the action of factor 12A, which you have studied in blood, right? Factor 12A stimulates this reaction. And once the plasma kallikrein is formed, it further stimulates factor 12 to 12A. That means the amplification of the reaction is occurring via both the pathways. They are itself regulating their own pathways. Plasma prekallikrein to plasma kallikrein, then plasma kallikrein activates more formation of factor 12A. Factor 12A will cause more formation of plasma kallikrein. And finally, the plasma kallikrein will cause conversion of high molecular weight kininogen to bradykinin. Similar step is in the tissue prekallikrein, which causes the tissue prekallikrein conversion to tissue kallikrein. Here the factors are not known, that is why there is a question mark. And tissue kallikrein will cause the production of kallidin or lysyl bradykinin from low molecular weight kininogen. The very important clinical question I will like you to remember here is that if you see this carefully now, there is a enzyme written over here by the name C1INH. C1INH. Just let let me remove everything else from here, this picture, C1INH, and just see over here, C1INH. C1INH is an esterase inhibitor known as C1 esterase inhibitor. C1 esterase inhibitor is an enzyme belonging to the serpin protein family. It's an enzyme belonging to serpin protein family, which normally inhibits several enzymes in the clotting cascade. It inhibits several enzymes in the clotting cascade. So just be with me in this. This is very, very important and a tough question for the exam. So C1 esterase inhibitor normally inhibits this step. That means there is no conversion of free kallikrein to plasma kallikrein, and it also inhibits the action of plasma kallikrein so that there is no conversion of high molecular weight kinogen to bradykinin. That means C1 esterase inhibitor is actually keeping in check the bradykinin production. It controls or keeps in check the bradykinin production. And remember, bradykinin is a very, very good vasodilator. It dilates the capillaries, it decreases the capillary transudation, it can cause a lot of increased interstitial tissue fluid accumulation. So we have a very important disease here, that if I have a C1 esterase inhibitor, mutation where this is not able to act, this leads to a condition where I will have a rare bradykinin mediated swelling disorder. There would be swelling all over the body because there is a mutation of C1 esterase inhibitor. It is not able to keep the bradykinin production in check. There is huge production of bradykinin, and I will have a rare bradykinin mediated swelling disorder known as hereditary angioedema. These are one of the very, very difficult questions for the exam, and they will only ask you again, as I will repeat once more, if you have done remaining everything correct, right? So mutation of the C1 esterase inhibitor leads to a very rare bradykinin mediated swelling disorder known as hereditary angioedema, right? So this was about the kinins, the bradykinin versus the lysyl bradykinin or decadin. Histamine, I don't have to tell you much. Last thing, histamine is a very powerful vasodilator effect on arterioles. It mainly increases capillary permeability, allowing leakage of both plasma and fluid protein into the tissues. So in many pathological situations, histamine, as you know, is mainly released from mast cells. It causes increased transudation of fluid. So in pathological conditions where there is excessive histamine, I can have lot of edema formation. Especially increased transudation can lead to edema in allergic reactions. In allergic reactions, there would be a lot of production of mast cell. Mast cell will release increased histamine. Right, so very important vasodilator effect. Then we have some peptides known as natriuretic peptides. These are the hormones of the heart, as we say, or the natriuretic peptides released from the heart. Let's look at what all do we need to know here. The natriuretic peptides are of three types. They are peptide hormones synthesized by the heart, brain, and kidney. Just remember their key names: ANP atrial natriuretic peptide, BNP brain type natriuretic peptide, CNP C type natriuretic peptide. Their actions are similar, which I'll be telling you in a while. This is a 28 amino acid peptide. This is 32, this is 22. The 28 amino acid atrial natriuretic peptide is mainly synthesized by the atria in response to atrial distension. When will the atrial distension occur? Whenever I have increased venous return and more blood is coming back to atria. Brain type natriuretic peptide was first discovered in the brain, so it was called as brain type or BNP, but actually it is also, we have discovered now that it is synthesized within the ventricles. But why it is called as brain? Because it was identified first in the brain. C type was third to be isolated from brain. Ab A B naam ho gaya tha, B B ho gaya tha, so they named them as C. Because I had used A, I had used B, so I just named the C. When the third was identified from the brain, it was called as C, right? So A, B, C, atrial natriuretic, brain, and C type. Let's discuss their actions. Their actions are a lot involving the other systems, so but dominantly they are released in response to increased atrial distension, which can happen due increased blood volume leading to increased venous return. Also, along with atrial distension, I can say cardiac distension because that will take care of the ventricular natriuretic peptides such as BNP also, right? So whenever we have increase in blood volume, increased venous return, there is increased atrial distension or cardiac distension. This will cause the production of ANP and BNP. What are their actions? First of all, they are very good vasodilators. They vasodilate. They are vasodilators. They relax the smooth muscle of the arteriole, causing decrease in mean arterial pressure. First action. Then what else apart from them being the vasodilators? So they will decrease the mean arterial pressure. The atrial natriuretic peptide and the BNP, once they are produced, they will decrease the renin synthesis from the kidney. Decreased renin will lead to decreased renin will lead to decreased production of angiotensin II. This I'll teach you today. Don't worry, just as of now, write it down. Everything we'll discuss in the blood pressure regulation. And decreased aldosterone. Angiotensin II and aldosterone. Angiotensin II causes the formation of aldosterone. Angiotensin II increases the sodium reabsorption in the proximal convoluted tubule of kidney. So when I have decreased angiotensin II, there is decreased sodium reabsorption in the PCT. Decreased aldosterone means decreased sodium and water retention. Together, these two will lead to decrease in blood volume. That means for decrease in blood pressure. Then I will decrease the reabsorption of sodium in PCT and decrease sodium and water reabsorption in the body. That means I am causing something known as natriuresis. Natriuresis means, nat means sodium, uresis means loss of sodium in urine. So natriuresis. Diuresis, loss of water in urine. Right? Also atrial and ANP and BNP, they will also directly increase my glomerular filtration rate. So I will be losing more water in the urine. And when my GFR will increase, it will again lead to increased natriuresis and diuresis, and also it will lead to decreased renin, right? So this is the broad action. If I have to summarize everything, I can say what are their main actions. So we'll quickly say They act on the kidneys to decrease the sodium reabsorption via the angiotensin II mechanism. They are decreasing the sodium reabsorption in the PCT, right? They inhibit the sodium and water reabsorption in the body via decreased production of aldosterone. They increase the GFR because they dilate the afferent arteriole. So they increase the GFR. And they are very important vasodilators, so they decrease the blood pressure, right? So these are some broad actions of the natriuretic hormone. Lastly, we need to know that the natriuretic peptide, three types of natriuretic peptide receptors are there. Again, figure taken from Ganong, NPR, as we like to call them in short, natriuretic peptide receptors. There are three types: NPRA, natriuretic peptide receptor A, B, and C. Just remember the key things here. The natriuretic peptide receptor A is specific for ANP. A and A go together. The C binds all three natriuretic peptides, and B has an affinity for CNP, greatest affinity. Just remember the A and A is for ANP, and C is for all. Now you can see there are three domains of the natriuretic peptide receptor A and B, which is extracellular fluid domain, cytoplasmic domain, and the membrane bound, right? So membrane bound inside the membrane, cytoplasmic inside the cytoplasm, extracellular fluid. NPR A and B have all the three domains. The cytoplasmic domains have the activity. They are the gonyl cyclases. These two are the cytoplasmic domains, are the gonyl cyclases. On the other hand, the natriuretic peptide receptor C does not have a gonyl cyclase domain. This question can be asked in exam. It does not have a gonyl cyclase domain, so it is mainly function as a clearance receptor. Clearance receptor का मतलब होता है it clears. Clears means remove करना. It removes the natriuretic peptides from the blood stream. It removes the natriuretic peptides from the blood stream. Removes the natriuretic peptides from the blood stream. It removes the natriuretic peptides from the blood stream, right? So natriuretic peptide receptors. So this last figure you can see from Ganong. This is just a summary of the factors affecting the caliber of the arterioles. There are various factors which are locally acting vasoconstrictors, endothelial products, circulating neurohumoral agents, and the neural factors, right? So I'll just skip on to this to save some time. Figure is exactly taken from Ganong, nothing new. And now I will start with the another important topic of today, which is the blood pressure and its regulation. Blood pressure and its regulation. This is actually, if you ask me, is one of the most important question, and you will certainly get a long question from this topic in your prof exam or sent-ups also. Even in terminals, they will like to give you one or two questions. So systemic CVS regulation. When I talk about systemic cardiovascular regulation, we need to know various things. In the first part of the lecture, I'll be telling you what factors affect blood pressure, what are the various types of blood pressure, what is the principle when I take the blood pressure by the BP cuff method, also known as the sphygmomanometer method. And in the second part, we'll be discussing about regulation of blood pressure and the various mechanisms important in regulation of blood pressure. So let's start with systemic CVS regulation. What are the things we need to know here? Describe and discuss the systemic cardiovascular regulatory mechanisms. Outline the various neural mechanisms that control the blood pressure, heart rate, including the receptors. Now, you have been taught in central nervous system by Dr. Ravi about the various reflex arcs. So, I will be expecting you to understand this in a better way now, because remember, reflexes are not only present in the CNS, but they are also present in the CVS, where I will like to call them as cardiovascular regulatory mechanisms, right? So there is an afferent, efferent, receptor, stimulus, integrating center, everything is there in the CVS as well. Yes. So what role does the nervous system have in regulation of the circulation? So nervous system is basically playing a role in the redistribution of blood flow, increasing the pumping activity of the heart, rapid control of the arterial pressure, and regulation via the autonomic nervous system. First part of the class I've already taught you in third or fourth lectures, which is the autonomic nervous system. Generally, sympathetic nervous system to the heart, let me quickly revise, is from T1 to T5, which supplies the cardiac muscles of the heart. Which supplies the cardiac muscles of the heart or cardiac muscles, right? So T1 to T5. Then we have T1 to L2, which supplies the smooth muscles of the blood vessels, right? Smooth muscles of the blood vessels. Remember, the blood vessels do not have a parasympathetic innervation. And also remember, the sympathetic supply via these two, thoracolumbar and thoracic T1 to T5. When I talk about T1 to L2, it supplies the smooth muscle of blood vessels, all blood vessels except capillaries, pre-capillary sphincters, and meta-arterioles. These three are not supplied by the sympathetic supply. They are actually governed by the local accumulation of the vasodilator substances such as hypoxia, hypercapnia, acidosis, lactate, potassium, adenosine, and so on. Right? So sympathetic vasoconstrictor system has more activity in the GIT, gut, spleen, kidney, and skin, and the coronary and cerebral do not have much effect by the sympathetic nerve activity. So I say the vasoconstrictor fibers are distributed throughout all segments of the circulation. They are less potent in the cerebral and coronary, and much more important action in kidneys, GIT, spleen, and skin. This is just a simple figure showing me a sympathetic vasoconstrictor system. This is the intermediolateral gray column or the gray horn of the spinal cord. From here, the fibers originate, which are known as preganglionic sympathetic fibers. They synapse in this ganglion, from where the postsympathetic fibers go. Either they will innervate the blood vessels or they innervate the heart. If they are innervating the heart, remember T1 to T5. If they are innervating the blood vessels, remember except capillaries, pre-capillary sphincters, and meta-arterioles, they are T1 to L2. That's it. Some fibers directly go to the adrenal medulla. The preganglionic fibers directly go to the adrenal medulla, where they will release epinephrine. There is another system which will be teaching you in cutaneous circulation in detail. The resident will teach you, that is sympathetic vasodilator system. So let me quickly show you the figure of the sympathetic vasodilator system. The sympathetic vasodilator system is special because this is commonly present in the skeletal muscles and sweat glands, and their role will be described in detail in cutaneous circulation. Just see their origin. They commonly originate from the frontal cortex, they relay in the hypothalamus and the midbrain, and then the fibers directly descend down to the intermediolateral horn of the spinal cord and release from the ganglion acetylcholine. Remember, sympathetic fibers always release norepinephrine, but here it is important that they are releasing acetylcholine, which is causing vasodilation. Norepinephrine usually causes vasoconstriction. And these fibers, they do not relay in the medulla. No relay in the medulla, right? So blood pressure. What we need to talk about the blood pressure. Let us discuss some important types of blood pressure, the factors affecting the blood pressure, and then the regulation of blood pressure. So blood pressure, what do you understand by the term blood pressure? How do I define blood pressure? What all I would like to know you here, the factors affecting blood pressure and its types, the various components of the systemic arterial blood pressure and their significance, the determinants of the arterial blood pressure, how is the BP regulated, role of baroreceptors in maintaining arterial blood pressure and the role of renal body fluid system in arterial pressure regulation. So very important topic, very, very important topic for the exam, right? And even in day-to-day life, it has huge clinical importance. So historical aspect, before I talk about the blood pressure, this was a person who first tried to measure blood pressure in a horse, and his name was Stephen Hales. So this is a picture commonly taken from internet and given in the very old books. So what he did was he ligated an artery in the horse and then tied that artery with the help of this very thin string or thread to a tree, and then applied a manometer to the tree and was trying to measure the blood pressure in the horse. This was way back in 1733. Then we had Frederick Mohammed, who in 1870 tried to insert a cannula in the patients who were undergoing limb amputation. Then Von Basch tried to place the balloon over the radial artery and pressed it till the pulse was obliterated. Remember, we'll be teaching you once you come back that how is the BP, normal BP recorded. Very important experiment for the exam. Must to know. So you all will be asked to buy your own sphygmomanometers and stethoscopes, and you should be proficient in measuring blood pressure at least during this first year. As the historical aspects passed, we now have the two famous scientists whom we are still following their way. The first was Stefan Rivarocki. The Rivarocki has given us that cuff which you must have seen at home maybe, or when you go to visit your family doctor for your parents or maybe grandparents along with them, that there is a cuff which we tie around the upper arm. That cuff is named after this scientist, Stefan Rivarocki, and he tied first a cuff around the arm and was connected to a mercury column. Finally, we have a scientist on whose name I hear the blood pressure sound, known as Nikolai Korotkov. He has described the appearance of characteristic sounds which I hear during the auscultatory method of blood pressure recording, right? So these are the two main scientists whose legacy we are still following. What is blood pressure? So let's try to understand what is blood pressure. So what is blood pressure and what all do we need to know here? What is blood pressure? So blood pressure is the lateral pressure exerted by a flowing column of blood. What is blood pressure? It is a lateral pressure exerted by a flowing column of blood. So let's say this is a blood vessel and the blood is flowing like this. Now this flowing blood will exert a pressure laterally on the vessel walls. This is known as blood pressure. So what is blood pressure? The blood pressure is the lateral pressure exerted by a blood column on the vessel walls. Lateral pressure exerted by the column of blood on the vessel walls. Lateral pressure exerted by the column of blood on the vessel walls. Commonly, as you know from the cardiac cycle knowledge, that the blood pressure fluctuates during cardiac cycle. I have the maximum blood pressure recorded during systole phase, which is known as systolic blood pressure. I have a minimum blood pressure recorded during diastole, which is diastolic blood pressure. Then I have a pressure known as pulse pressure, which is also written as PP. So what is systolic blood pressure? The BP fluctuates during the cardiac cycle. This systolic blood pressure is the maximum blood pressure recorded during the systole. If I don't want to use the word systole, I can also say maximum pressure recorded during the cardiac cycle. Naturally, maximum pressure during the cardiac cycle will be recorded in none phase other than the systole. So this is systolic blood pressure, right? And diastolic blood pressure. Then we have another one which is known as mean blood pressure. or as I say, mean arterial pressure. It's the same thing. The mean blood pressure and pulse pressure. What is the difference and on which factors do these pressures depend? That is the first part of this BP concept. So systolic blood pressure, maximum pressure recorded during the systole, diastolic minimum, pulse pressure is nothing but systolic minus diastolic. And mean blood pressure, remember mean means average. So actually it should have been this. Should have been, but it is not. It should have been this, but this is not what is mean. Mean is rather diastolic blood pressure is 2/3 plus 1/3 of systolic blood pressure. And very important, explain why for the exam, that why mean blood pressure is not the average when we keep on blabbering that in PSM you will study that mean is average always. So remember the systolic plus diastolic divided by 2 would be the average when the duration of systole and diastole is same. The problem is diastolic blood pressure has a greater contribution to the mean blood pressure, which is nothing but the average pressure exerted throughout the cardiac cycle. Why diastolic has a greater contribution, 2/3, and why not half? Because just go back in your mind and cardiac cycle, diastole has a duration of 0.5 out of 0.8. Systole only 0.3 out of 0.8. If you will do for me 0.5 upon 0.8, you will approximately get 2/3. That means the diastolic blood pressure has a greater contribution to the mean blood pressure because of a longer duration of diastole. Please remember this, explain why. Very important question. Mean blood pressure is the average blood pressure exerted throughout the cardiac cycle. That's it, right? Now, what are the factors on which it depends? What are the normal values? So normally these normal values keep on changing, but as of now we say systolic blood pressure is in the range of 90 to 130 millimeter mercury. Diastolic is in the range of 60 to 85 millimeter mercury. Pulse pressure is approximately, we say, around 40 millimeter mercury, and mean blood pressure is actually approximately 93 millimeter mercury. So once we know of the normal values, their definition and basic concept, you can be given a numerical based question to calculate the mean blood pressure in the exam. One formula I've told you, another formula you can derive easily from this, or you can remember directly. Another way to write mean blood pressure is, it is diastolic blood pressure plus 1/3 of pulse pressure, right? So this is one of the very, very important MCQs for the exam. They will like you to identify the correct formula. They will like you to calculate the mean blood pressure. Something like, I give you a very quick one question. So they will ask you like this, okay, calculate the mean blood pressure given the systolic blood pressure is 150 millimeter Hg and the pulse pressure is 60 millimeter Hg. That's it, right? So no choices. Let's try to do this. So when the systolic is 50, remember I need diastolic, but if PP is 60, then naturally the diastolic here will become 90. And once I know 90, I can easily calculate whatever way you like. 90 plus 1/3 of PP, so 90 plus 1/3 of 60, answer would be 110. Or you can do 2/3 of 90, which would be 60, plus 1/3 of 150, which would be 50, again the same answer, right? So this is the way we commonly, you can be asked a numerical based question in the exam. So let's erase this off and try to go back to another important things to understand, factors which affect the blood pressure. Factors which affect each of these blood pressures, and what is the basic meaning of the variations of the blood pressure. So factors which affect each of these blood pressures. This is one of the very, very important things. The factors or the determinants So before I discuss the factors or the determinants, remember a few another important features about the systolic blood pressure. Systolic blood pressure normally we say undergoes considerable fluctuations. It undergoes considerable fluctuations in day-to-day life. I'll tell you very quick some situations where you will be able to understand what do I mean by this. Undergoes considerable fluctuations means, okay, suppose you start doing exercise, kya hoga? Naturally systolic blood pressure will increase, right? You eat something, eating of the food will increase your metabolism, increase sympathetic discharge. You are anxious, anxiety, excitement. All these conditions will increase. I'm also telling you indirectly factors which affect BP, right? So this is very kritish stuff. You can read yourself as well. So exercise, eating, anxiety, excitement will increase the sympathetic discharge. Some of the conditions where the systolic blood pressure can fall or decrease. Yes, definitely during sleep, as during sleep, the sympathetic discharge is less. Then during, as you know, when we do meditation, then also the sympathetic discharge goes down. Very in thing these days. A lot of people are under stress, so they want to do meditation, sleep, and also whenever you are resting, relaxed, right? All those conditions naturally will decrease the sympathetic discharge and will decrease the systolic blood pressure. So it undergoes considerable fluctuations. The first point. What else? The systolic blood pressure actually tells me, it tells me the degree of pressure which the arterial walls have to withstand. The degree of pressure which arterial walls have to withstand. That means more is the systolic blood pressure, more is my arterial walls are subjected to a high pressure. So degree of pressure to which arterial walls have to, degree of pressure which the arterial walls withstand, right? So now let's come back to the diastolic quickly. Just like this, we'll see some of the important significances of diastolic blood pressure. So diastolic blood pressure, when I say diastolic blood pressure, it undergoes much less fluctuation. It undergoes much less fluctuations in comparison to the systolic blood pressure. I'll tell you soon why. And it basically indicates the constant load against which heart has to work. Constant load against which heart has to work. Pulse pressure, if I say, what does it signify? It basically determines your pulse volume. Remember, you have been taught, or you would be taught already, must have been taught, otherwise we'll be teaching you in a while, how to determine the pulse, how do you palpate the radial pulse. So when you palpate the radial pulse, the blood comes and strikes the wall of the vessel. At that time, I am trying to determine your volume of the pulse. That is determined by the pulse pressure, right? Pulse volume. Mean blood pressure finally, what does it signify? The mean blood pressure signifies, as I told you, average pressure throughout the cardiac cycle, or we can say it is same for each organ. It is same for each organ, and it basically determines the pressure head. Remember, delta P, it determines the pressure head. So it is same for each organ and it determines the pressure head. Remember, this was the blood vessel. The pressure is coming like this, P1, P2, P2. This P1 is the mean arterial pressure, which is same for all the organs, and this will determine whether how much blood will go in will be determined by P1 minus P2 or delta, right? That is what we meant here. All cardiovascular reflexes are sensitive most to mean blood pressure, right? And now, what are the determinants of these blood pressure? What are the determinants of these blood pressure? So let's do one by one the determinants of these blood pressure. Systolic blood pressure, always remember, is directly proportional to the stroke volume and inversely proportional to the compliance of the vessel wall. If you ask me, till now we have been just doing the easy stuff. This is the most important thing which you need to actually know for the exam, and you need to understand this. The systolic blood pressure is directly proportional to the stroke volume and inversely proportional to the compliance of the vessel wall, which is the main vessel, as you all know, aorta. That is why sometimes I will say compliance of aorta. What is compliance? In respiratory physiology, you have been taught. In CVS also, you know, compliance is stretchability or distensibility of the blood vessel, delta V upon delta P. With the change in pressure, how much my vessels can distend. Now, systolic blood pressure is directly proportional to stroke volume. That is very simple to understand. More is the stroke volume, more will be my systolic blood pressure. Why? Because stroke volume is the amount of, or the volume of blood ejected in one beat. So the vessel will have more blood, it will be pushing out. That means it will be needing more pressure. Compliance, why it is inversely related? Remember, if the vessel, let's say this is my blood vessel and I push in lot of blood volume. If the vessel stretches and becomes like this, if the vessel stretches a lot and becomes like this instead of the red one, when I push in the blood, what is going to happen? The vessel stretches a lot, it has a very high compliance. As you know from Boyle's law, if the vessel stretches, there is very high compliance, the systolic blood pressure will reduce. So in case of increased compliance, the systolic blood pressure will reduce, right? What are the factors on which diastolic blood pressure depends? Diastolic blood pressure is directly proportional to total peripheral resistance, and it is also directly proportional to elastic recoil of the vessel. Remember, elastic recoil, wind Kessel effect. So it is directly proportional to elastic recoil and total peripheral resistance. If the total peripheral resistance is high, the diastolic blood pressure is going to be high. If my elastic recoil is more, my diastolic blood pressure is going to be more. Now you know that aorta has a lot of elastic tissue. So its elastic recoil will be high, leading to a good amount of diastolic force, which is diastolic blood pressure. Very interesting question. As people age, as we age, my vessels become, my vessel becomes stiff. As my vessel becomes stiff, the compliance of my vessel reduces. It cannot stretch more. And if the compliance reduces, so as we age, there is increased chances of systolic blood pressure increase. That is why older age people, we generally say hypertension to hona hi hona hai, na? As we commonly say, as you grow old, 50 ke baad, 60 ke baad, everyone will have hypertension because the vessels are naturally becoming stiff. They cannot expand. So systolic blood pressure will have to be, the same blood volume will now have to be accommodated in a lesser space of the vessel, because the vessels cannot stretch or distend. So the systolic blood pressure will increase, right? Then we move on to PP, or the pulse pressure. The pulse pressure is directly proportional to the stroke volume upon compliance of the vessel. It is directly proportional to the ratio of stroke volume upon compliance. For a given blood vessel, compliance always determines pulse pressure or the systolic blood pressure, not diastolic blood pressure. And it also does not determine mean blood pressure, because the mean blood pressure is nothing but mean blood pressure is a product of cardiac output into total peripheral resistance. Cardiac output into total peripheral resistance. This last one is very, very important, because cardiac output is none other than stroke volume into heart rate into TPR, total peripheral resistance. Remember, these factors are interdependent. They are not acting individually. So you always have this confusion. People will immediately ask, sir, if total peripheral resistance is decreasing, that means it is vasodilating, then sir, cardiac output should increase. So according to this, you know, mean blood pressure should fall, but cardiac output is increasing, so it should increase. What is the answer? What will happen to the mean blood pressure? Which out of the two factors are more important? If I'm having severe vasoconstriction, sorry, if I'm having severe vasodilation or very severe vasodilation, this will fall much more and I might have a fall in blood pressure. If I have a huge increase in cardiac output, then I can have the increase in mean arterial blood pressure. So these factors are interdependent. Let me make you understand this with very good one more example. Let's say usually I talk about that the mean blood pressure is equal to stroke volume into heart rate, and let's say your heart rate is increasing. As the heart rate will keep on increasing, we understand the mean blood pressure will also increase. But the catch here is that with severe increase in heart rate, just see this figure now. So this is heart rate, this is stroke volume. Just understand what we are doing here. So this is a value which is very, very important for you people. This is 180, this one. What do I see is, till the heart rate goes on increasing and increasing and increasing, up till 180, I have increase in stroke volume with increase in heart rate. But after 180, my stroke volume starts reducing even with increase in heart rate. So what happens is, up to 180 with increase in heart rate, the stroke volume increases, thereby the mean blood pressure increases, right? But what happens is, after the heart rate has increased to more than 180 per minute, with severe increase in heart rate, with very severe increase in heart rate, duration of cardiac cycle will decrease, as we understand, right? But what I see is that after I have crossed 180, the cardiac cycle duration decreases. Nonetheless, the decrease in diastole duration is much more than decrease in duration of the systole. Very quickly, I'll give you one example as the scientists have seen this. So let's say that my heart rate was 75 per minute, and at this time systole was 0.3, diastole was 0.5. Now my heart rate increased to 200 per minute. What will be the duration of cardiac cycle become? When my heart rate increases to 200 per minute, the duration of cardiac cycle will become 60 upon 200, which is 0.3 seconds. What do I observe? Now my systole becomes 0.15, and diastole also becomes 0.15. As you can see, beyond 180, the diastole has decreased much more in duration than the systole. This has a huge implication because now see the formula carefully. Although heart rate is increasing, but diastole duration has decreased, and diastole is the main phase in which ventricular filling takes place. So if I have a decrease in duration of diastole, there would be decreased ventricular filling leading to decreased stroke volume. So I am not sure whether my mean arterial pressure will increase now or decrease. That is why we said these factors are independent, or sorry, these factors are interdependent. They are dependent upon each other, right? They are not acting individually. Also, you should know in any individual, I can calculate the maximal heart rate by a very simple formula, 220 minus your age. So 220 minus age. If somebody is 20-year-old, or you people are not even 20, so 220 minus 20 would be maximum heart rate which you can achieve when you start exercising or doing any other thing, 200, right? So when the sympathetic discharge will increase, maximum heart rate a 20-year-old will achieve is 200. A 50-year-old will achieve, a 70-year-old will achieve 150, right? An 80-year-old will achieve 140. So these are the factors on which the blood pressure depends. So lastly, there is a concept of this curve. Let us look at this curve from Genong. This is a curve telling me that this is mean arterial pressure tracing along with time. This is a mean arterial pressure tracing along with time. And what we are saying is that mean arterial pressure can be recorded from an arterial pressure tracing. This T1, T2 is nothing but time. So this is time. And they simply say that the highest pressure is nothing but systolic, the average is going to be mean, and the lowest is diastolic. This is an integration formula which they have given us, which you don't need to know. So this is just a figure which is a mean arterial pressure tracing along with the time interval involved. Also, we have a very interesting concept which is known as shape of the pressure pulsations. Just see this figure from Guyton now. Shape of the pressure pulsations. What do we mean by this? So the typical record of arterial blood pressure, the typical record of the arterial blood pressure at the root of aorta is known as pressure pulsation. That means first I will have systolic, then diastolic. So a typical record at the root of aorta is a variation between systolic and diastolic blood pressure, which has been known as pressure pulsation. Now, what we see here is that this is first phase is showing systole. Let me highlight this. Second is showing diastole. The first pressure curve is from the aorta, proximal aorta, as it is written over here. This is aorta. This is from a systemic artery, which I will call as femoral artery. The second figure is from femoral artery. The third is from radial artery, then arteriole, and then finally capillary. You have to actually see here nothing but the variation or the difference between systolic and diastolic blood pressure. So as we can see that in comparison to the aorta, the variation between the systolic pressure, remember this is systolic pressure in the aorta and this is diastolic pressure. In the proximal aorta, this is the systolic pressure and then this is the diastolic blood pressure. So the variation in the aorta is only this much. The variation in the proximal aorta is this much. In arteriole, the variation is negligible, and in capillary also, the variation between systolic and diastolic blood pressure is negligible. So this concept is known as, this is known as damping of the pressure pulsations. Damping of the pressure pulsations. What do I mean by damping of the pressure pulsations? Damping means, the damping of the pressure pulsation simply means the progressive diminution or the progressive decrease of the pulsations in the periphery. Progressive diminution of pulsations in the periphery. What is the reason for this shape change? Sabme alag alag shape hai. In aorta, we are seeing this shape. In femoral artery, different shape. In radial artery, another shape. In arteriole and capillary, also different shapes. So what is this reason for the progressive diminution or the shape change of the pulsations in the periphery? What is the reason for this shape change? So now we have the answer. We say the reason for the shape change in various vessels is, it is directly related to, it is directly related to the degree of damping is directly proportional to the product of resistance to the blood movement in the vessel, resistance to blood movement in the vessel multiplied by compliance of the vessel. So more is the resistance, more is the compliance, more will be the shape change or the progressive decrease of pulsations in the periphery. Now, in comparison to the aorta, in comparison to the aorta, in major peripheral artery, such as femoral artery, in major peripheral artery, we are seeing systolic blood pressure is higher and diastolic blood pressure is lower, leading to increased pressure pulsation. So why in major peripheral artery the systolic blood pressure is higher? Because in major peripheral artery, in comparison to the aorta, the compliance of the femoral artery is less. Decreased compliance with respect to aorta. You know, less is the compliance, more is the systolic blood pressure. Aorta, on the contrary, has a high compliance. So it has, in comparison to a major peripheral artery, less systolic blood pressure. But what is the reason for decreased diastolic blood pressure in the major peripheral artery? It has less elastic tissue. So what is going to happen here? Because of the increased systolic blood pressure and decreased diastolic blood pressure due to the decreased elastic recoil, the pulse pressure is high in the major peripheral artery in comparison to the aorta. Now let's look at the figure again. In the aorta, the variation, if I look up till here, or even if I see from here to here, it is this much. But over here, the variation is much more. Why? Systolic blood pressure is higher than the aorta due to reduced compliance. Diastolic is lower due to decreased elastic tissue. This concept is known as pressure pulsation. Right? Pressure pulsation. How do we measure blood pressure? Let's go for this very, very important concept-based question for the exam. Commonly, you must have seen when you have visited your family doctor, they tie a BP cuff around your upper arm and inflate the cuff with the help of this instrument, which is connected to a rubber tubing known as a bladder, right? Or a manometer. And a manometer is attached to the BP cuff where we see the readings. So we have this kind of the scale over here on which various markings are there, right? Most of you must have seen the BP cuff. If anyone has not seen it till now, don't worry. You will have to buy your own and we'll make you learn the recording of a normal blood pressure along with effect of postural change on blood pressure from lying to standing or supine to standing and lying to sitting. And also we'll be asking you to record the blood pressure during exercise. Very briefly, I'll tell you what is the mechanism behind the BP recording. Although this is a practical question, but many people are not able to answer properly. That is why I'm discussing here. So the principle of blood pressure recording is, or measurement of blood, so regulation of blood pressure I will do tomorrow. So class representative, kindly get in touch with me, Gauri or Sukman, and please let's do a class for tomorrow where we can finish off regulation of blood pressure and hypertension. And then the last class I will take on Tuesday, which is heart failure and shock, right? So major, and just get in touch with me whenever you are free today after the regular schedule, right? Or after 4 p.m. any time you can call me. So measurement of blood pressure, what is the principle behind? Remember, there are two methods. In the older time, we were using direct method. Direct method mein what we will do, used to do, it is also known as intra-arterial method. We will directly put a cannula into your artery. Cannula is attached to a manometer and we will measure the blood pressure directly. Okay, but definitely this is an invasive method. Aise koi karayega nahi, nobody will let me do like this. So we have moved to the methods known as indirect methods. In indirect methods, or many of the methods have become popular because of the simple reason they are non-invasive methods. Commonly based, they are based on various types of sphygmomanometers. They are based on various types of sphygmomanometers. So in the older time when I was the MBBS student, then we used to do in our college by the help of a mercury sphygmomanometer. Then today you are doing it with the help of a manometer known as aneroid. Mercury means usme mercury was filled. Aneroid means it is filled with air. But the principle remains the same. The principle of the sphygmomanometer method is, now please listen carefully. The principle is, and the rest you will be taught in practical class, but now I'm telling you the main crux. This is the blood vessel normally. This is my normal blood vessel. It could be my brachial artery over here where I'm right tying the cuff, right? This cuff is tied. So let me make a cuff. This is the cuff. The cuff is known by the name Riva Rocci cuff. The Riva Rocci cuff was given by that scientist which I told you, and the Riva Rocci cuff has some standardized dimensions. There is a rule. The length of the cuff upon width of the cuff. The length of the cuff should cover 80% of the arm circumference. The width should cover 40% of the arm circumference. That means length and width ratio has to be 2:1. Now please understand, you know this already. Normally the blood flow in the vessel is, what is this? Laminar. Normally the blood flow is laminar. Laminar blood flow. Normally. So if I ask you to put the stethoscope on your brachial artery without tying a cuff, and I ask you, batao sunke, what are you hearing? So you will say, sir, the normally blood flow is laminar. Laminar blood flow does not produce any sound, no sounds. That means there should not be, you should not be hearing anything. Now, what do I do? Please see, very interesting concept. Now I tie the cuff and I keep on inflating the cuff. As I keep on inflating the cuff tied around your brachial artery, the vessel becomes like this. The vessel constricts because I have compressed it with the pressure. So there is decreased cross-sectional area of the vessel due to compression by the cuff. And now what is going to happen? Just go back. If the cross-sectional area reduces, what will increase? The velocity of blood flow increases. And as the velocity of blood flow increases, your blood flow will convert from laminar to which blood flow? You already know the answer. Turbulent blood flow. And as soon as my blood flow becomes turbulent, I start hearing sound which are known by the name Korotkov cough sounds. So, what is the principle of the blood pressure recording by the sphygmomanometer method? You will just give me a one-line answer: conversion of the laminar to turbulent blood flow. The Korotkov sounds have been ascribed various phases. There is a phase one, this is the last thing for today. Phase one. Phase one is the appearance of clear tapping sounds. When I hear clear tapping sounds or the phase one of Korotkov sounds, they correspond to systolic blood pressure. More about this we'll be teaching you in practicals. Then we have phase two, three, four, and five. In the phase two, the sounds become softer. The sounds become softer. In the phase three, the sounds become crisper and louder. So softer and longer, crisper and louder. Phase four, we have muffling of the sound. Muffling means intensity kam ho jayega. And the phase five, we have disappearance of the sound. Disappearance of the sound corresponds usually or the phase 5 to diastolic blood pressure. In case you are not able to make out disappearance of the sound, then you will say phase 4 as diastolic, but you will mention in the reading. So suppose you give me a reading like this: sir, my BP is 120 by 80. If you haven't mentioned anything, it is implied that this is phase one and this is phase five. But if you write like this, my BP is 120 upon 82, phase four. That means you have not been able to understand phase five. So you are telling me I could not appreciate disappearance. So I'm only telling you, sir, muffling of the sound. Then I will make you hear the disappearance, and this is the way we will learn, right? So we have a stethoscope from which two tubes are coming. One I can put in my ear, the another one you can put in your ear, and we can try to corroborate the sounds simultaneously. But all this will only happen once you join back. People whose parents are doctors or they have stethoscope at home, maybe they can practice BP, blood pressure till the college reopens. And once it reopens, then definitely will make you learn. You need not worry. Right? So class representative, kindly get in touch with me today after 4, and we need to take one more class, which is tomorrow, otherwise on Sunday, but I think tomorrow would be better. I don't want to spoil your Sunday. So tomorrow morning or afternoon, whatever time you say, right? Morning I can take from college only, afternoon I'll take from my home, and that would be regulation of BP, short-term mechanisms, intermediate and long-term mechanisms, and hypertension. These are all the topics for tomorrow. And then on Tuesday, last lecture of mine, there I will do the heart failure and shock, right? Chale, goodbye for today. Take care, and probably most likely we'll be meeting tomorrow. class is a must for all of you to attend, because tomorrow's class would be one of the most important high yield topics, right? CVS entirely is very important, but tomorrow's class, certainly you get a long question, either renin-angiotensin system or either baroreceptor or CNS ischemia. So tomorrow is actually, you can say, the D day of CVS. We need to make up time afternoon or morning to understand the very important concept of BP regulation, right? Chale, goodbye for today. Take care.